Let's start it from the beginning. You started by borrowing, you know, $200 or so from your father. Why?
Why did I borrow $200? Or why?
Yes. How did you pitch your first startup to your dad?
Well, I didn't really have to actually pitch. It was my father. So I mean, I you know, came from humble beginnings and you know, started. My school actually was in 1989. Installed the very first computer room when I was 10 years old. And this was, you know, way before the internet, way before Windows even. It was like MS-DOS and GW Basic and CC++ and these green colored monochrome terminals with 5 1/4 inch floppy drives. And for me, it was kind of love at first sight. I was always fond of math and physics. And so for me, progressing into computer science just became a natural progression. And I would spend all my free time, like short breaks, lunch breaks. My father, who, by the way, deserves pretty much all of the credit for where I, my brother, and we are today. I mean, he's an amazing, amazing person. Bought like 40 or 50 different books on programming in different languages. And I would just sit there. We couldn't afford a computer back at home. So I would just spend time in the computer room. The teacher would leave like the key to the computer room with me. And I would spend 3 hours after school coding. It also helped that it was a boys only school, so no other distractions. But I knew really early on, I read, the other thing that I read a lot of back then and still do is a lot of biographies. So I was really inspired. I very clearly knew, I was a, you know, scrawny little kid who knew that he wanted to build a company and had to be in tech. And I started consulting, doing some odd work. And then eventually started, you know, my first company with my brother. We bought a server in the US in a company called Alabanza, and to pay for the first quarter, we needed actually about $300, and so borrowed that from my father. And
but how do you decide at such an early age you want to build a company?
It's actually the least risky time to decide to build a company, if you think about it. You know, no responsibilities. I can always go back to academia or whatever else. If this doesn't work out. So in some sense, it was actually the most obvious logical conclusion for me that.
So you were 17 and your brother was how old?
15.
So you started to you bought a server, and then what happened? Did you hire a team immediately, or you started to code first and?
Yeah. So in the first year, I remember we made a modest $10,000 profit, which for us was a lot of money actually back then. Uh-huh. I had a team of about 4 people and grew that on an ongoing basis. Started selling domain names and hosting and email services globally. And then kept growing that. We became the first ICANN accredited domain registrar in Asia Pac. And what we did is, so one of the things that I did early on is I built out, I mean, I've always been a techie, and still all of my companies that I run today, they're all sort of tech focused.
Yes.
And so I built out this entire platform, which essentially enabled anybody else to put up their own storefront and their website and sell our products to their customers in their country.
Okay.
And that worked out really well, because in 3 years we signed up upwards of 3 to 5,000 resellers around the world. And by the end, you know, when we sold the company, we had 50,000 resellers around the world who were buying products from us and selling them to their customers in their local sort of language and country.
So like an affiliate network for you?
A reseller network, not really. So they would actually buy, and they would kind of co-brand, rebrand, and they would handle the customer support, billing, customer acquisition, marketing, etc. So it was a pure, proper sort of reseller network.
Okay. So you have this company, and then what brings you to think about other companies? Why not stay with this one and build it all the way to how far you can get it, but think about other things? Why? Were you bored?
So firstly, I mean, I've always fundamentally believed that each of us has a moral obligation to make an impact that's proportionate to our potential. Like, I think all of us have been given this amazing gift of life, and we...
Say it again, this is too important.
I mean, each of us has a moral duty and an obligation to make an impact that's proportionate to our potential. Thank you. So that's what's driven me at all points. I mean, I still think that I have a long way to go in terms of fully exploiting, you know, my capabilities and my potential, which is why since then I've actually founded 3 other companies that I currently run and operate. That one we exited back in 2014. And it's just, you know, I also, I mean, to partially answer your question, I think I've always also seen that frustration in some ways is a genesis of entrepreneurship. So, you know, most of us, actually by a show of hands, how many entrepreneurs, founders, startups in this room actually? That's Yeah, so lots of people would relate to that, right? Like, we look at a problem, we get frustrated about it, then we're like, why the hell is nobody else solving it? And they're like, screw it, I'm gonna solve it myself. And so that happened a bunch of times, and so I'm right now mostly involved in the last two companies that I started, Flock and Zeta. One of them is a productivity suite, so email, messaging, etc. for companies. A space I'm really passionate about. I strongly believe in trying to like extract out the absolute maximum efficiency I can from every minute in my life.
Yes.
And so I figure if I can do the same for teams and individuals worldwide, then that's a huge opportunity to make an impact. And then Zeta, which is in the payment space, which also to me, I'm supremely passionate about the space. And to me, there's something sort of fundamentally wrong about the way that space has been digitized. Like the fact that cash still exists today is an anomaly. It shouldn't. For all practical purposes. And so we started thinking about this from first principles base. I co-founded that company with another person called Ramki.
Yes.
And we started thinking about this from a first principles basis in terms of, well, how do we really make a meaningful impact in the payment space?
Let's stay there a little bit, because if you know, Elon Musk is a big fan of the first principles. Can you explain what it means? Because this is super valuable for startups especially.
Yeah, I think that many of us actually have an inherent advantage of when we're starting out a new company. So I've started companies in five different spaces, you know, domain names, hosting, email, online advertising stuff, payments, messaging, etc. And it's amazing what you can do when you kind of look at the whole world with completely sort of fresh eyes, you know, completely sort of first principles. So when we started thinking about Zeta, for instance, I started the company really in 2015, but Ramki and I started discussing the idea around it 2014. So every day, every week we would do a bunch of homework and research of sort of, you know, the payment space around the world and, you know, things about, you know, regulation, technology, what are the, you know, pain points that people are feeling, what are the anomalies in the system, what are the opportunities, etc. And we started thinking about, well, you know, ignore, you know, the payment infrastructure as it exists today. But if you think about the technology, the possibilities that exist today, if somebody had to build an entire issuing system from scratch or a banking platform from scratch, what would that look like? And so we had both the advantage and opportunity to actually have had no previous baggage from being in the payment space. So we could look at it from first principles and really solve the problem in a way a scientist or a mathematician kind of derives something from ground up. And that's really when you tend to end up getting insights that you otherwise wouldn't develop because you're prejudiced by all these sort of preconceived notions and things that already exist out there. And I think Peter Thiel talks about in his book, 0 to 1, right? Like it gives you the opportunity, when you think from first principles an engineer, it gives the opportunity to kind of think 0 to 1 and make that kind of innovation leap. After which everybody's then just sort of incrementally improving the status quo, but not really looking at a problem with completely fresh eyes.
Okay, I understand. Now, for the audience, if you also want to chip in with some questions, if there's something you want to know, feel free to ask. It's super easy. All you have to do is just pull out the mobile phone and open your browser. It's that easy. And you just type in, as you can see there behind me, slido.com and the hashtag #cupgrind. And that's it. You just ask away. And what we promise to you that the top 5 questions will be answered. And which ones you will decide, because you can vote for questions which you like. So simple. Okay, now Bhavin, you built a couple of companies and you are a big proponent of, you don't have to go out and raise funding immediately, you can also bootstrap a little bit. What are your secrets to bootstrapping successfully?
Well, I guess I can answer that question in two parts. So, you know, firstly, I've had the good fortune of being able to bootstrap my first set of companies and then invest the profits and revenues and capital generated for some of the exits into subsequent companies. And so I'm actually an anomaly in some sense because I've never raised any funds so far across all of the 4 companies that I've been a part of. They've all been kind of organically grown. I'll say 2 things. You asked sort of success to sort of, you know, secret for success in bootstrapping. I mean, to me, I guess I can talk about general principles of success and there's tons of stuff I can talk about out there. But the 3 things that I think I'll leave people with is, to me, the predominant ingredients of success in running my organization or my company. I call it TAP. So it's talent, alignment, and prioritization. So hire the best talent, the absolute best people you can possibly get. And I spend, even till today, I spend 30 to 40% of my time on recruitment.
Okay, tell us how. How do you spot the best talent? When you speak to people, what are some signs that this is somebody interesting?
Okay, so there's some philosophies that I can talk about that I've also sort of made tons of hiring mistakes and I've kind of learned along the way. So this notion of generally trying to make sure that we hire about the mean of our team, and always, so mathematically, every individual that you add in your organization or team, if they're above the mean, above the average score of your organization or team, then you're always adding additively, you're sort of increasing the score of your organization, as opposed to hiring about the mean. Many times you'll find managers basically, in an interview, they walk out, they're like, yeah, this guy's not that, this person's not that great, etc. But he's better than this worst person that I have in my team. So if I hired that person, why not hire this person, right? And that's the philosophy of hiring about the min, but that will consistently reduce the score of your organization.
Lower the quality, yes.
And the other thing that we want to sort of always look at is, well, can we learn something from this individual? If we're excited about bringing them into our organization, we feel like, well, we can learn something from the individual. That's another kind of,
When you're hiring, do you give homework to people or do you ask them to solve a problem during the session? Or how do you do that?
We do have pretty intensive interviewing processes. For instance, one of the biggest departments and functions that we hire, and the one that I also spend a lot of my time optimizing, is engineering.
Okay.
We go to the top sort of engineering institutions in the countries that we operate in, specifically in India, where a large chunk of my product team is, and hire some of the best people. Typically, sort of interview 6,000 people to make 50 offers or so. And there's sort of algorithmic rounds, so for algorithmic coding, etc. There is in-person problem-solving rounds. So in essence, we're looking for we're smart people, so people who are smart, people who get things done, and sort of are proactive and have that hunger. People have humility, because we fundamentally believe that if you're not humble, you sort of stop learning. And that's kind of what we're trying to evaluate for, apart from the skills that you would generally need on the job. I remember we consistently started raising the bar of the kind of individuals that we bring into the organization, to a point where, by the way, I actually sometimes fear that if I leave my company and reapplied, I probably won't get in. We've consistently been raising the bar, and it's been so interesting because 2006, 2007 is when we started doing that, and we found, interestingly enough, that the best way to attract the best talent was to make the interview process extremely difficult, because then people actually talk about how they got through this really complex interview process and spread the word amongst their peers, and that kind of snowballs into this, oh my God, it becomes almost a brag value to get through the interview process in itself.
Okay, so you're hiring people for the smartest people, and what are two other things which you...
Smart, gets things done, humility.
Yes. Humility, okay. Now, you running not one company, you're running right now two companies, and you are chairman of the third company. How can you do it, especially when the teams are all over the world?
So I wouldn't recommend it, by the way. One of the things that I preach actually in most of these conferences and meetings is focus, and I myself don't practice it, which is kind of a bit of a hypocrisy there. But I got tempted three times over and I started three companies. The good thing is the first one, Radix, which I started in 2012, I now have a CEO. He, along with his team, kind of runs the entire show, so I am actually just showing up for strategy meetings. With Zeta, I have a co-founder who actually also takes a significant amount of the burden, and so there again, I have help. And the other thing is that over time, because I've been doing this for 20 years now, we've built the kind of right platform, the right ecosystem to be able to recruit fast. I've got a really good supporting network. I've got people who've been with me for 18 plus years across the various companies that I've started and founded. So certainly, I would never be able to do this without the stellar team and the people that I have. And if there's really anything that I can actually take credit for and be proud of, it's being able to hire some amazing people that are really fun to work with and that actually take on a lot of the burden.
Okay, so you delegate a lot to your teams and to...
So I guess it depends on phases and stuff. One of the things that I do really enjoy is the build phase. Which is part of the reason why I find myself in this quandary of running three companies. But I love sort of building companies, and I spend a lot of my time on, product strategy, and a lot of my time on recruitment, and then sort of large strategic deals. I have an amazing management team that takes on a lot of the burden I can delegate to.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about the bootstrapping versus fundraising, because I know that you start as a bootstrapper, And now there's a company, one of your companies, which is going to be fundraising, or it's fundraising now. How is that?
Yeah, so as I said, I don't prescribe one or the other. I think we were in a good sort of, you know, space to actually be able to bootstrap multiple companies and then subsequently fund some of my latest companies. I do think that there have been some advantages that I have seen of kind of bootstrapping in the at least, you know, journey in the first 10, 15 years.
Yes.
One of the things that I've seen that happens in sort of, especially in overfunded companies, which by the way, funnily enough, is actually a symptom these days in the market if you see, is the tendency to substitute creativity with cash. And it's so easy when you've got $100 million in the bank, you're like, okay, I'm instead of thinking a sort of an interesting creative solution for a problem, I'm just gonna throw money at it. And the problem there is that, you know, well, you can throw money at it until the money runs out, but then you're building this muscle memory in your company that always substitutes creativity with cash. Versus a scenario where, I mean, some of the best, you know, adversity is in many ways the mother of invention, right? So when you actually have to be scrappy, and you have to figure things out because you have lesser resources is when you're forced to be creative. I mean, evolution sure. works the same way. And so in many ways, I think that's one of the key advantages that I've been able to leverage across the journey of bootstrapping some of these companies.
So some of the companies you co-found with your brother, some of them with somebody else. And is there any company you started on your own?
So Radix and Flock, I started on my own, and Zeta, I co-founded with Ramki.
Okay, and we have a question here on Slido, and the question is, solo founders are far less likely to succeed. Do you agree?
I kind of do agree. So I mean, but again,
and why?
Less likely, you know, it's kind of saying that, well, companies that don't manage to raise funds are less likely to succeed, and then, you know, I would be a paradoxical anomaly in that sense. So I don't think there's any kind of formula for success in that respect. But I do think, I mean, if I take the example of my last company, Zeta, which I co-founded with Ramki, and he's kind of worked with me for 10, 15, 10, 12 years before we co-founded this company. Honestly, I think the two of us together, the impact actually multiplies. So what I could do, I mean, I could certainly start this company on my own, he could start it on his own, but what we can create together in terms of impact and meaningful value is actually a multiplication of a magnitude, significant magnitude more than what we could have done sort of individually. You know, sometimes entrepreneurship also gets lonely, right? It's actually fun to have somebody along the ride, you know, to springboard ideas off, bounce ideas off, and sort of discuss stuff and get opinions, especially if somebody that's really smart, that you can trust, that can bring a different viewpoint to the entire conversation. So it's definitely really helpful. But the thing about co-founders, though, is that, I mean, at least in my case, my first co-founder was my brother, my second one was somebody that I'd worked with for a long time. And this is also sort of an interesting dilemma, right, which is that the best partnerships I've seen is where you sort of start a company with somebody you have worked with for a while or have at least known for a while and sort of become co-founders along yes. the way. And so, you know, that sort of is an advantage.
And now when you start running these companies and keeping doing fundraising and having external partners, how does it change the culture of the company?
Sorry, we haven't raised any funds so far in any of the companies.
Okay.
Yeah, no. So Flock, Zeta, and Radix are all currently just sort of funded by me and organically grown.
So you're thinking about doing it?
Yeah.
Okay.
For some scaling stuff that we may choose
cool.
to.
So you briefly mentioned the culture of these companies, you know, humility and smart people. How would you define the culture of the company to people you are hiring?
So, I mean, culture fitment is actually definitely an important part of our recruitment and hiring process. And in fact, in many ways, we actually think about when we're inducting individuals, and that's why I mentioned sort of smart and humility and gets things done. Those are actually three important values amongst others in our sort of stack of sort of cultural values as an organization. We do want to test for that. And we've typically found, I mean, as we grow as an organization, if we sort of practice what we preach and we maintain that sort of, you know, so focus on our cultural values, etc. People who don't align well automatically end up kind of, you know, moving away to something else.
Yes.
But I can tell you the scaling companies, I think, is easier than scaling culture. It's actually the most difficult thing to scale. In fact, there are fundamentally, you know, so for instance, you want to get your first entire set of hires right? The first, I mean, Reid Hoffman actually says that you want to be personally involved in hiring the first 150 people in your company and make sure that they're all a culture fit to ensure that subsequently that process sort of carries on. And, you know, culture becomes easy. Now, a lot of people take things for granted, you know, at below a certain inflection point. So culture is quite easy when you're a 30, 40, 50 people organization. You're all sitting on the same floor. You can literally, if you stand up, you can see everybody in the office. Everybody knows everybody on a first name basis. And you generally end up meeting everybody at least once a day, yes, somewhere or the other. But now you're a 500 people company, and there's departments and floors and silos, and you've got the sales department on the first floor and the support department on the second floor. And suddenly the communication that you took for granted that would automatically happen by default, you actually have to, so I call it engineering serendipity, right? You have to actually manufacture serendipity and manufacture those circumstances that you would otherwise take for granted in order to sort of ensure that sort of that culture continues to permeate.
Okay. People make mistakes, and I'm sure you've made a few. What would you say were some of your biggest mistakes, and how did you overcome them?
Sure, yeah, tons. I mean, I can tell you for a fact that every entrepreneur has gone through their series of sort of failures and mistakes on a continuous basis. I made tons myself. I think some of the biggest mistakes I've made are actually product management and product-oriented mistakes, and in fact, therefore, the biggest lessons I've learned are in that space. I have built tons of stuff, or got my team to build tons of stuff that I was sure everybody would buy and the whole world would need, but it was crap and nobody actually wanted it, and they completely failed as products and didn't make any sense. And it came from my perspective of how I saw the world, but I over time kind of realized that you have to validate this stuff, create MVPs, go out there and talk to customers early on. In fact, fake sell stuff before you actually build it, which is really actually quite easy in our industry because prototyping really takes no time. And so, many of the mistakes that I've made have resulted in sort of effectively spending resources and capital on stuff that then
Some good advice. So fake sell stuff, what do you mean by that?
So there's lots and lots of techniques these days, and so easy, right? So I mean, today when we build a product, we'll always build it after validation. So for instance, we'll go out there and talk to clients with mocks and wireframes, kind of, gray area boundary, but sort of pretending that also on the assumption that we know we can deliver it within 30 to 45 days, okay. But we'll go and sell with mocks and wireframes. We'll create fake doors for features. So you have a product and you think, hey, wait a minute, if I add video calling to this product, it's gonna be, the next best thing since sliced bread. Well, don't just go ahead and build the entire video calling stack. Just add a button that says start a video call, which does nothing. Somebody clicks on it. It says this feature is coming soon. Thank you for sort of trying it out, basically. Thank you for sort of, sort of experiencing, clicking on the button, right? So but now you can calculate, you can measure all this stuff, you can measure the interaction, yes, with some of these sort of validation experiments, and then realize truly whether the path that you wanted to take, does it make sense or not?
Yes, so you also built successful companies, you made some exits as well. How did you decide to sell the first company?
So interestingly enough, I guess I've never built, and even today I'm not building any of the companies that I'm building with the purpose and goal of exiting. If anything, quite the opposite. And even the first company that we sold back in 2014. So it's interesting actually, because in 2012, I was starting Radix, and I actually approached Hari, who's a good friend of mine, who was running Endurance back then, to see if he wanted to put a small amount of money into Radix along with me. So I met him in Dubai, spent 2 hours talking to him, like pitching him the whole idea, saying this is going to be an amazing company, I'm starting it now, etc. And next day he turns around, he's like, I'm not interested in investing in Radix, but will you sell me your other company? And I'm like, what? That wasn't the intent at all. But then we sort of continued talking about it for 6 months, and it became this whole strategic deal that made sense for everybody, included sort of employees, us, etc. So we went ahead with it. So it wasn't a planned exit. And I guess that's another luxury of, bootstrapping my company, because I actually don't have to deliver an exit to anybody else. I'm my own sort of master in that sense. And so there was no pressure to exit at any point in time either.
And when you get to a point where the company could be sold to somebody, do you usually hire M&A advisors, or how do you go about that?
So the first time I didn't. We actually just had that one bidder. We worked with them. We ended up with a deal that we thought was really fair to everybody and made sense, and learned a lot. I mean, I tend to go dive really deep into sort of all the aspects of anything that I enter into. So I did the sort of agreement drafts along with lawyers that we hired. I did sort of the tax planning along with sort of the tax consultants that we hired, etc. The second company that my brother sold, Media.net, we actually hired bankers. Actually, one set in China, one set in US for the rest of the world.
Yes.
And then went through sort of the standard sort of banker process. I mean, I would certainly advise, again, I guess early stage makes no sense, but at a certain stage, a good set of advisors will actually, one, be able to sort of expose you to a larger number of sort of potential acquirers, two, take a lot of, especially if they're, you know, good guys, who take a lot of burden off of your, you know, M&A and selling your company and raising funds is actually by far, at least I find, it's by far the most boring process. You have to go and repeat the same presentation over and over again, have conversations with multiple people, and so any help that you can get is always it's always welcome.
Did you learn any tips on how to pump up the value of the company or how to negotiate better the deal? Because Media.net, which got sold for 900 million, was a good deal, and it was a Chinese company. Can you tell us about the negotiation process and the difference in cultures?
So, sure. So actually, that was actually a very interesting negotiation process that we went through. In fact, I remember this one intensive week in China that I was negotiating a deal, and there was this battalion of kind of lawyers, lawyers, investment bankers, and whatever on their side, and there was me and, you know, two of my bankers. So it was 18, you know, 12 to 18 people against sort of the three of us. And it was actually a fun process to say, you know, so firstly, of course, there's a language barrier because everything I'm talking about then gets translated and then gets translated back and so on and so forth. It's interesting, actually, in one of the dinners, I learned a few Chinese words, and I happened to just generally sort of greet a few people in Chinese. This was a dinner after the first day of meeting. Uh-huh. And they suddenly got scared about the fact that, hey, could he hear and understand everything that was going on in the room before, you know, earlier today? In China, actually, a lot of the regulation was very, very different. So I actually had to do a much more deeper dive in terms of sort of local regulation there. There were some interesting negotiation tactics that were also being used in terms of sometimes they'll sort of change one of the material terms and be like, oh, unfortunately, the regulation doesn't allow for this. And if it wasn't for the fact that I'd actually studied some of this stuff, and I'd be like, well, wait a minute, this was changed at this point in time, etc. And then suddenly they're all surprised about like, hey, how does he know? But if I hadn't done that, then there would have been like several points that we had to kind of give up or give back on. And to answer your first point, I mean, I think in many ways, I think to me, any of these negotiations, I think the ideal outcome is only achieved if you actually have a win-win scenario. And so it's truly important to understand, you know, which sort of even happened in the first company that I sold, to truly understand, you know, what the buyer is, what are they looking for, how is your asset going to add value to them in a meaningful way, what kind of value will it add to them. I mean, I think to me, whether it's a sale to a customer of a product or a sale of a company to a potential buyer, to me, the successful formula is if the value that you can add to them as a buyer is greater than the value that you get in return, it's a win-win scenario. But the whole negotiation process then comprises of you figuring out exactly what meaningful ways you can actually add value to them, and then figuring out, therefore, the right kind of premium you can command for your asset.
Okay, that's fair enough. Let's look at some questions from the audience. Victor wants to know, what three living founders do you look up to the most and seek advice from?
Well, Elon Musk, certainly super inspiring, and one of my favorite, most favorite ever biographies that I've ever read. I'm going to actually skip on the living piece out there because, I mean, I think, you know, in many ways, Steve Jobs has actually been another supreme sort of inspiration for me. And Bill Gates back in the day. In fact, I read more than 8 different biographies of Microsoft between sort of, you know, 94 and 98. And in many ways, you know, he was a huge inspiration for me to kind of start up something on my own.
Okay, thanks for the tips. Now, next question is, can you recommend the one biography?
I think I already covered that, yeah.
So we got
so
it.
Elon Musk's biography is by far, I mean, amongst the latest ones, the best that I've ever read. And largely also because, I mean, I think both Elon Musk's biography and Steve Jobs' biography, one of the most important things that it teaches you is the fact that they've all failed multiple times, right? Steve Jobs was actually kicked out of the very company that he founded by the CEO that he brought into the company.
Yes.
And then unsuccessfully, kind of moderate successfully, then next for 10 years before he sort of, you know, did what he did with Apple. Elon Musk has almost reached bankruptcy a couple of times with both Tesla and SpaceX. And in fact, the book actually really highlights those phases and periods. And it's really amazing to learn and to understand. I mean, all of us sort of go through the same stuff. I mean, the struggle.
I agree. And you can learn things which normally people don't know. Like, for example, Steve Jobs was put up for adoption by his parents, and they were 19 or 18 at the time, and they had no money to care for him. And then a year later, his sister was born, and she was giving way to another family. And when they grew up, she found him, and they started to hang out, and because she was his biological sister. And she told Steve, and this is at the time when she was at Apple already, he was at Apple already, and she told him, hey, Steve, I would like to find a parents. And he goes, okay, but you know, they gave me up, I don't want to meet them. And about 4 months later, she came to him again and said, she hired a detective and they found his dad, because his mom was already dead. And she's going to meet him next week. And she asked Steve, it's a true story, if he wants to come. He says, no, I don't. So she went to see her father and Steve's father, and she came back, and after the meeting she went to see Steve and told him that he's a nice gentleman, nice guy. He used to be a restaurant manager because he retired by the time. And his father was telling her that he was working in multiple restaurants, and there was a highlight of his career where he was working in a very good restaurant, like a high-end restaurant in Palo Alto. Which used to have lots of celebrities coming in, and he said even people like Steve Jobs were coming into the restaurant. And this guy had no idea Steve Jobs was his son. And before she went to meet him, Steve Jobs made her promise she would never reveal who Steve Jobs is to him. And it was this weird situation where he was bragging about a son he gave away. And as she was telling Steve this story, he goes, I remember this guy. I know who he is. He was kind of a nice guy, but he never met him, and his father died already, and he never knew that Steve Jobs was his father. So this is the kind of stories you can learn from these biographies. So thanks for sharing those tips. Next question I'd like to ask is, what did you do early on to hire developers? It is so difficult to get good ones, right?
Well, I mean, me personally, actually, I was a techie at heart, so I at least knew how to kind of identify the right talent. And I also strongly believe that, so which is why I speak about, I think, in fact, forget all of the stuff that I said, there's one principle that's been the most instrumental for my success, it's hiring the best talent. It's really the area that I focus on day in, day out, every single time. I sort of obsess about it in terms of constantly improving our kind of processes to source, pitch, attract, and identify the best talent, right? And I also believe, therefore, that in order to actually do a good job at it, you have to dive yourself deep enough into the subject. And then also, I mean, potentially, if you're not a techie, then get help from people who you know are techies that can help you sort of identify and bring in good talent. The question here is, I think, also about attracting the sort of best developers. And I think this philosophy applies not just to developers, it applies to pretty much anybody. Uh-huh. Is that people are not looking to work for, you know, a person or a company as much as they're looking to work for a cause. So if you have a purpose and you have a story and you are trying to do something and make a change in the world and make an impact, people will rally towards that, right? So when you want to go out there and hire, no matter what size you're at, in fact, you know, a lot of people say, I'm a startup, I can't attract the best talent. And I'm like, in many ways, you actually have the opportunity to attract the best talent because you have a blank slate. You have the opportunity to sort of carve your own story. You have potentially the most precious sort of commodity, which is equity in your company, as compared to sort of a, you know, large organization that is sort of a safety sort of paycheck. And so in many ways, you have all the ingredients. But if you rally people to a cause or a purpose, you'll find it easy to kind of attract talent.
Okay, attracting talent, how do you find them? Do you go online? Do you ask your friends for recommendations? Or
we use that. I mean, one of the philosophies that we've followed, I mean, a lot of times recruitment departments and talent acquisition departments try to optimize for cost. And we actually want to do the opposite. We're saying that we want to spend more on a per person basis than anybody else. And that seems logical, because if I want to hire the absolute top 0.1 percentile, I can't expect to be paying the same cost that everybody else is paying to hire the people. So we actually parallelize the process as much as possible, use agencies, best of the sort of, you know, talent gets inducted from referrals, online job posts, you know, social media. Like, we'll use every single channel that we can possibly get. And we don't care what the cost is, because cost of recruitment is a one-time cost. Eventually, this individual is going to, you know, stay in your organization for years, and after that actually continue to add value for a long period of time. So we use a omni-channel, multi-pronged approach.
Okay, so we're wrapping up now, but there's a question here from Christina. You running multiple companies, and you must be super busy, and I'm sure you not a boring person, you have some interests. How do you manage all that?
Yeah, so I mean, I guess this, you know, I was talking about this when I spoke about my sort of passion creating Flock, that I personally am I have a huge penchant for productivity. So I try and extract as much efficiency as I can out of my time in every meaningful possible way. So I mean, I have, you know, four homes and three offices that I work out of. Everywhere I have like this perfect setup that's a document that my assistants kind of follow in terms of three monitors, a video conferencing unit, the exact same desk, the exact same chair, which has kind of gone through, you know, layers and layers of experimentation, get shipped to all these places, etc. I'll try and optimize. I mean, the fundamental philosophy I have is that anything that I repeat more than three times either needs to get delegated with a process document, etc., or needs to get automated, one of the two. So for instance, I have, in the last 15 years, I haven't shopped, period. I think it's the biggest waste of time ever. There's a document that tells that basically my assistants follow in terms of buying or getting stuff made with regards to all of my clothes. I have a fairly similar wardrobe across all of my homes that I frequent. Yeah. So I mean, every single activity that I repeat more than X number of times, I have to figure out a way to either delegate it or automate it, and that sort of keeps it going in terms of sort of efficiency and
productivity. Okay, and you didn't tell me anything about your interests. How do you balance them with efficiency and all these other companies, right?
Well, I love what I do, so I spend a vast majority of my time doing what I do. I like adventure sports, so I mean, I sort of indulge in occasionally in snowboarding, skiing, wakeboarding, wake surfing, etc. Love anything that sort of taxes me physically or mentally. Not that I'm great at any of them, but I'll enthusiastically participate.
And my very last question to Bhavin is, I have to ask this because this is too important. You say that each of us has a moral obligation to create an impact proportional to our potential. But how do you estimate that potential?
Right, so this is an interesting paradoxical loop, right? Which is that if each of us has an obligation to make an impact that's proportionate to our potential, by default, as we will continue to sort of journey through life, our potential keeps increasing. So it's a never-ending process. That's why I kind of talk about this also in various forums, right? Which is that I actually like to think of life's journey not in terms of sort of milestones of success, but as a pursuit of mastery. And that's what I love about kind of the notion of mastery, right? Which is, success is binary. So you set a goal, you achieve it, and you feel you've succeeded, and it's done, it's over, and it's a sort of line drawn in the sand. But mastery, pursuit towards mastery is never ending. I mean, you could be a musician and you could pursue mastery for the rest of your life. You could be an entrepreneur and you could pursue mastery in that for the rest of your life. I'm quite certain each individual has sort of the ability to sort of realize what their current potential is, but then the more you kind of try keep making an impact, the more your potential also increases on a constant basis. I mean, it's also physics, right? Potential energy is a function of how high you are, and hopefully you are sort of constantly rising as you're making an impact, and therefore you have more potential energy that you can then use for making additional impact.
It's a good scientific answer. Ladies and gentlemen, Bhavin Turakhia.
Thank you. Thanks everybody.
Now, we're a bit late on time, but we're going to catch up, and this is useful. That's why I wanted to give the time to hear what Bhavin thinks about things. And now it's time to talk about the other side of the story, opposite to bootstrapping, and this is about investing. And raise your hand, show of hands, of how many of you are looking for funding or are going to be soon looking for funding. Okay, there's a bunch of you. Cool. So you're at the right place, because now we're going to be talking about an investor Q&A. So please join me in welcoming Gary Stewart from Wayra. Gary, welcome. And we have an investor from Draper Esprit, Diana Krantz. Hi, Diana. Welcome. Gary, the show is yours.
All right. Sorry? Okay, perfect. Well, thanks for being here. I mean, it's really impressive that there's so many people coming out to listen. My name is Gary Stewart, and I run something called Wayra in the UK, which is an accelerator backed by a company called Telefónica, which you guys know better as O2. We've invested in about 185 companies in the UK. 40% of them have gone on to raise more than a million. They've raised cumulatively $257 million. And I guess for us, what's even more important is they've done about 130 trials with Telefónica, which is for us more important than the money that they raised. But we only invest up to 150,000, which means that a lot of times our startups are going to eventually go out and look for companies like Draper Esprit when they need a lot more cash. So that's the reason why I think it's really cool that we have Diana Krantz with us today. And Diana, in true entrepreneurial mode, I wanted to ask you, what's your 1 minute pitch? Can you tell us a little bit about who you are in 1 minute? Not so much Draper for the moment, I'll ask about that afterwards, but who are you?
Yeah, sure. Thanks so much for having me. So I'm an investor with Draper Esprit. Technically, what that means is I look for startups in the kind of A, B, and C rounds that we would invest in. You want a bit of my background or kind of...
Okay. Your background.
Right. So before this, I worked operationally at a company called Rocket Internet, which a few of you might know. So we did a copy, which Rocket Internet is known for, of a company called ClassPass. And after that, I worked also operationally with Techstars. Before that, I worked for a hedge fund and did some like diplomatic stuff. So I've been doing a bunch of different things.
Okay, and I want to get back to Rocket Internet a little bit, but tell us a little bit now about Draper Esprit. How much money do you guys have? What sort of companies are you looking for? Are there particular verticals that you focus on? Give us a sense in about 1 minute again.
So I think, really loud. So Draper is a bit of a different beast because we are not a traditional fund. We are public. So we IPO'd the fund in 2016. So that means that we don't have like a pool of money that other funds have where LPs have invested in us and we have 10 years to return the money. We are an evergreen fund, so it means that we can be much more aligned with entrepreneurs. We can invest whenever we want in any stage of a company's lifetime. We can stay as long as we want. So that kind of answers the question of how much money we have, but we invest about 100 million pounds per year. So if you multiply that over five years, that's kind of, you know, you can, yeah. So we look at, as I mentioned, ABC investment rounds, any type of vertical.
I'm not sure everyone knows what ABC is, or does everyone know what an ABC round is?
So kind of post-seed round. So we'll invest between 5 million pounds as a ticket size up to 25 million in any vertical across Europe. So we do everything from kind of really deep tech, hardware things, up to like consumer apps.
Okay, great. So going back now throughout your journey, Rocket Internet, I guess there are a lot of people that see it kind of like Marmite. They've been very, very successful, but like you said, their model has been about copycatting, and now I guess in Africa they have some issues there as well. Tell us a little bit about kind of what were the key lessons that you learned from being or working with a Rocket Internet startup?
Yeah, so Rocket obviously is like super different from a traditional startup. Often what they do is like they'll see a successful model in the US and it's a model that's already been proven, and they'll be really fast in copying that model in Europe or Asia or anywhere else, and then the idea is technically to sell that back, like let's say it's eBay or Amazon or whatever, to sell that back to them. You can argue that like everything is a copy of everything else, but it was a good learning curve. I think you just work really, really hard, and you have technically most people at Rocket don't have any equity because you just get hired as like a massive corporation. So it's a good learning curve, but it's not something I would probably want to do for a long time. And I think it's very different, as I mentioned, to kind of working in a traditional startup, but it gives you still the understanding of like what it takes and how hard you have to hustle and like how scrappy you have to be and like all the KPIs you have to meet. And like, I mean, it teaches you all the traditional stuff that you get in the startup.
But I guess these guys have been around now for a long time and they've been generally successful. So what is it that you think makes them successful that could be transferable to other entrepreneurs, even if they're not backed by Rocket?
What makes Rocket successful?
What makes Rocket successful?
It's a really hard question. I think they're really, really focused on hiring the best people. And I think, I mean, that just translates into any startup.
So then let's go on a little bit now to your Techstars days, because you were 7 months in Techstars, so that was kind of earlier around the same stage that we are in. Tell us a little bit about that experience and kind of what you saw there in terms of what startups need to do to raise money. Like, how did you help them to raise money, or what were the lessons that you learned there?
So Techstars, just to give you some background, is a tech accelerator. So we select startups that are pre-seed and who have a product, who have a team, or kind of an idea of a product, And then for 3 months or 6 months, they're with us, and we help them get to the point where they can actually raise money from seed investors. I think one of the best things that Techstars gives you is the network, because you get really, really close to a bunch of VCs, especially, I was working in London, so there is something called mentorship sessions where all the VCs, not all, but most of the VCs around London come in and they pick, or they get to mentor all these startups, and you get 20 minutes each with a VC. So you get a personal connection before you actually ask for money, which I think is really important, because it gives the VC the opportunity to kind of give you feedback on what they will need to see from you, and then kind of gives them the sense of I helped shape the startup and I helped them, they listen to my feedback. And so when you actually get to the point of raising, you'll know them personally, you'll have heard what they need to see, and you know what metrics to hit, and you have that relationship. So that's one of the kind of big things. Another, I think, learning point from Techstars was, and very much their motto is give first. That's kind of everything, that's what they live by. And what that means is before you ask for something, give. Always be generous with your time, with your resources, with everything. And I think I still kind of live by that. I try to do, even if Draper would not invest in a startup, I will always try to connect them to someone who I think would be relevant for them, or connect them to, where, if it might be a potential hire or another seed VC or another VC. You just always try to be helpful.
So I want to go back now to kind of how VC works, because you were mentioning before that you guys don't have LPs. That means that you have a kind of slightly different model.
Yeah.
But I read recently that kind of only 5% of VCs ever give back any sort of a meaningful return to their fund, meaning that only 5% of VCs are considered successful and then can raise other funds. Given that, why would a startup need to go to a VC? I mean, initially you can get a little bit of cash, but it seems that there's a kind of very small number of VCs that actually can help you to become a unicorn or to become really, really big. Give us a little bit of a sense as to how you take that into account. What's the value added of having a VC, particularly if you have the option of bootstrapping or just relying on, nowadays, family offices, high net worths, et cetera?
Yeah, well, I mean, depending on what kind of business you want to build, you don't necessarily need to go to a VC. There's a lot of reasons for why you shouldn't. And I think if I was to do a startup, I'm not sure I would go specifically to a VC, because, it depends what kind of startup you want to build. But if you want to build a kind of world-dominating unicorn, then yeah, you might want to move really, really fast. You'll need that extra money to hire those people. You need more money to just get ahead of the competition. Not everyone, will have the luxury of being able to bootstrap based on previous exits. It all depends, I think, on how far you want to go, and if you want to build a lifestyle business, or if you want to build a world-dominating company.
But then, even then, how do you choose the VC, right? Because there are a lot of VCs, and one of the things I think about startups is that VCs almost have a mythological nature to them. It's they're all-knowing, and they are all-powerful, but the reality is, I think, a lot different from that. So, given the fact that there are a lot of VCs in London and other countries, some of which are good, some of which are bad, how do you choose a VC as well? And going farther, should you be choosing a VC, or should you be choosing a particular investor within the firm?
Right. Well, yeah, and so also to answer your previous questions about 5% of VCs actually manage to return. So it is a really scarce resource, right? It's not a liquid market. So the best VCs will be the ones who manage to identify the best deals and then actually get into the best deals. And so only the top quartile will actually manage to return their fund. What was the other question?
No, the other questions were,
why you should go to VC?
How do you choose
How do you choose a VC? Right, sorry. You should definitely choose a VC. Well, I would think it depends what stage you're at in fundraising, but I think you should definitely choose a VC that you think will be able to help you specifically. So let's say if you're a hard tech company building hard tech technology, then you definitely want to go to VC that has that expertise, that has that skill, that has done that before, that has partners who have done all of that before. I think it's such a broad question. I'm kind of struggling to even
Okay, so I'll give you some examples of things that I've heard, right? So maybe you can check the portfolio companies and see how happy they've been with the
founders. Definitely, yeah.
Another thing that you might be able to do is to see how they deal with failed or failing companies, because a lot of times some investors, once they see that you're failing, they kind of kick you to the curb, whereas others kind of will really kind of add value. Some have value-added services like talent acquisition, other things like that. So, I mean, I guess like now VCs are also trying to differentiate. So give us a sense as to kind of like what are the things that when you're looking for a VC as a startup, how do you do your due diligence? What should you be looking for? Who should you be talking to? What should you be asking?
So you should definitely, as you mentioned, speak to a portfolio companies who are successful, but also portfolio companies who failed, because you want to know like the ones who failed, or like failed is the wrong word, but the ones who didn't see the exit that they wanted, how were they treated, or how did they reference this VC? You want to, I mean, as you mentioned again, like before, I think VC was quite a scarce thing. So you could just show up with the money and people would take it. Whereas now you actually have to prove yourself. You have to actually have to have a whole portfolio of services, like hiring services, introduction, network, product, like CFO, anything. And so I think all VCs are trying to figure out like how they can be different, how they can prove themselves. And it depends, again, what stage you're at or what you're looking for. A lot of founders are actually just looking for the money because they think they have everything it takes and they have the network. So then you just go for the money. But if you're looking for people who've done that before, people who help you hire, then I think a lot of it will be referencing people who have taken money from that VC before. Not every, like if you look at Atomic or Excel, like they're two extremely different companies on their website. So like Atomic was very vocal about like, these are all the services we provide, whereas like Excel aren't, but they're still two really, really good VCs. So like it's really hard to figure out just by doing research online. You actually need to speak to people, speak to them, speak to everyone you know.
And then I guess a part of the question was, do you go for the firm or do you go for the investor? Because maybe the other way of asking this question is, what are the downsides of taking VC money? When I got VC money, for example, for my startup, I didn't take it seriously. I just took it like this was the money. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, the person who I had been dealing with wasn't the person that ended up on the board. And I hated the person that ended up on the board. And so eventually, I just left my own company because I was like, I don't want to deal with that person. So how much should you be focusing on negotiating who's going to be on your board? Because at the end of the day, the board is what controls the company, not necessarily the management team. So tell us a little bit about what are the downsides of having a bad VC inside your company?
Well, the obvious downside is that you lose you give away part of your company, right? So the VC will have a lot of opinions and a lot of things to say. So you should definitely be very picky with what partner you get on the board. I think I've never heard of that happening before. It definitely doesn't happen at Draper. So the person who will be interviewing, or not interviewing, but like the person who will be speaking to you during all these weeks when you're fundraising is most likely the partner who you will get on the board, because that partner will probably have that experience in terms of, you know, having built an enterprise SaaS company or having built a hardware company. So definitely the person is super, super important. You'll be married to that person for like 10 years or however long it's going to take you to exit. The downside, I mean, all the things that you'll, like a lot of them you'll have to think about when it comes to term sheet. And I don't know if that's something we're going to talk about later, but like, you know, you need to think about like liquidation preferences. You want it to be ideally like 1x, not 2x, because like if one time comes to sell the company, you want to maximize your own takeaways. You want to think about veto rights. Like what does the VC have to say? Like can they, like let's say you want to sell 2-3 years in and it's a decent exit for you, it's not going to be a decent exit for the VC, but like can they veto that exit? Like let's say you want to sell for $5 million, that's not going to be what the VC wants, but can they veto that or not? You want to think about like what do you need to get approval on by the board or by an individual board member. You know, is it like hiring 100K person? Then do you need to like you want to like make your operations as lean as possible? So like there's a lot of things that you need to think about.
And then one thing before I look on the board, which I've been doing anyway, is sometimes now you're seeing like more of a trend of funds that are kind of founded by entrepreneurs instead of by former bankers. right? Because the idea is that entrepreneurs will have more entrepreneurial empathy. They'll actually know how to help you get through certain challenges rather than maybe VCs who've never been there and done that. How do you think that's a relevant factor when choosing a VC, that a person actually has been an entrepreneur, him or herself?
I think there's a lot of debate around that. I personally would agree a lot, but I think, but I don't have the numbers. Like, I don't know statistically if that is actually true. I get it. Like, I get that you want to have an operational, you want to have a partner who has operational experience, who's done this at Uber, who's done this at WhatsApp, who's done this at Waymo, whatever. But I do also think that if you choose a start, if you choose a VC who has a strong brand, like who has a really good reputation, they will have the network to introduce you to all the right people. They will have a really strong portfolio, and you'll be able to leverage that portfolio and get intros and learn from people who've done it before. They will be able to introduce you to the corporates that you want to work with and kind of like initiate those partnerships and help you with sales. So I don't think anyone can say yes, like what's right and what's wrong. I definitely get why people want to work with those kind of partners.
And then another kind of like comparative question, and this goes to one of the questions I saw before, which is valuation. Because we just recently came back from Silicon Valley with some of our startups, and there we saw that everyone was a lot more willing to help. You can go to someone who's a partner at a fund, and they just seem like a lot more accessible, at least for the first 15 minutes, and evaluations are a lot higher. Mm. Whereas in the UK, sometimes it feels very standoffish, and evaluations are a lot lower.
Right.
So if you're an entrepreneur, how do you navigate that? Should you be going more to look inside what you can get from the US and hope for more money at a higher valuation and probably even more network and more access? Or should you be looking primarily to the UK?
I think you should be looking in the UK if you're UK focused. You want to have a VC that's close to you that can actually come and see you, take the time, be adjacent. You should definitely go and look for US VCs if you're going into the US, if you're expanding, because there is a big probability that they will have a stronger network there. Like one of part of the sales pitch for Draper is that we have something called the Draper Venture Network. So we have a whole network of VCs all around the world. We have something, and there's a team in Silicon Valley who just do corporate intros and who just kind of help on like US expansion. But I think valuation wise, you also need to be really careful, because what we're seeing a lot in Europe right now is these startups that raise at a valuation that, let's say, would be too high for Draper because we just don't think that's reasonable. Then they come back 12 months later or 18 months later. They actually have kind of priced themselves out of the market because they weren't able to kind of get to all the proof points that they were supposed to. And the valuation at the last round was massive. So now they have to do a down round. So I think you need to be really, really careful with valuations.
Brings up like a point that when we were in the Valley, we were talking to kind of Steve Blank, and he was, I guess, the godfather of lean startups. And someone asked a question, one of our startups, do you still believe in lean startups? Because you have companies like WeWork that can raise like $2 billion. And his answer is, if you can raise $2 billion, and it's also the first question there, should you raise what you can or what you need? Mm-hmm. If you can raise $2 billion or whatever the quantity is, go for that, because you can kind of crowd out a space a lot more quickly than if you went for the lean startup model. So how would you respond to that? If I could actually raise $10 million,
yeah,
and that means that I could have like so much more of a competitive advantage relative to my competition, why wouldn't I do that? Why would I only raise 500?
Because if you raise too much, then at the next round, so let's say you raise it, I don't know, 20 now. If you raise in like 12 months from now or 18 months from now, you want to raise a 2x or 3x that valuation. However, if you haven't gotten to that proof point in terms of revenues, in terms of KPIs, in terms of, you know, retention, whatever kind of startup you're building, you will not be able to raise it 2-3x. You'll have to raise it a flat one. That's the biggest downside. So, but yeah, I mean, I think if you ask a startup, they will tell you raise as much as you can when you have the money. And like someone like Amazon will be a good example where they managed to survive throughout the financial crisis because they had so much money in the bank. And I think you need to be careful. But if you can raise money, you feel free to take it, but be very careful about how you value your company, because think about the next round and what you need to prove out.
All right, cool. I think last question, because I see we're wrapping up, is the second one that we have here. One of the other things I realized in the Valley was that like there's a lot more affirmative support for female entrepreneurs. It was kind of like their funds now only for women, and if your team doesn't have a woman on it, people will call you out for it. Give us a little bit as to how you see the kind of evolution of female entrepreneurship happening in the UK, and is it a good or a bad thing, and what tips would you have for female entrepreneurs?
The one tip I would have is be much more bullish than you are, because often what we see is men CEOs come in and they're extremely bullish on themselves. They're like, yeah, I'm definitely gonna hit this, this is a no-brainer, whereas female CEOs are much more realistic. So I'd say be more bullish, because you're being compared to the male CEOs. Try to meet, and I don't know if this is good or bad, but I would recommend trying to meet a female investor, and don't be afraid of speaking to associates or kind of investment managers, because they will be your champion. You don't need to speak to a partner. Like, partners often won't take time. So like the investment associate that you're speaking to will be your champion, and they will push your deal. And so they're as valuable as the partner. I see it a lot, and like as you mentioned, there's a lot of funds popping up doing only female investments. I think women have become much, much better at like being visible and kind of being proactive and like taking up space in the room.
All right, well, I think that's all the time that we have. I see Marion coming, so thanks, Diana.
Thank you.